All right, today we're going to talk about non-destructive testing. So, right, we'll do kind of a quick overview of non-destructive testing, what it is, and we'll talk about the six most common methods used in NDT and the six methods that the OSHA Corporation trains in. I will go over some different applications as well as different industries that it's commonly used in. So the definition of non-destructive testing, what do we define NDT as, right? It's the use of non-invasive techniques to determine the integrity of a material, component, or structure. Or you can also use it to quantitatively measure some characteristic of an object, right? So what does that mean? So it means you are non-invasive, right? You're not damaging, injecting into, compromising the material that you're testing, right? So, you know, if you're doing a destructive test, right, like a bend test, right, you're damaging the part, right? You can't use it after you test it. Non-destructive testing, you're not damaging it, right? So think of x-ray, think of ultrasound. You're able to look inside a material without causing harm to it, right? Or, right, you're measuring some characteristic, either the dimensions or you're measuring its conductivity. You could be measuring its heat treatment, right? So if you're heat treating steel, right, you can make sure that you're properly heat treated it. Right, you're not doing harm to the test's piece, right? You're not damaging it. That's the whole key. So you can be testing in-service materials, you can be testing things as they're being manufactured, and still be able to sell them after you produce it. So different methods of NDT, right? There's a whole slew of them out there, right? Microwave and testing thermography, right? Acoustic microscopy, acoustic emission, right? Magnetic measurements, different types of magnetic measurements, everything from magnetic particles, through eddy current, ultrasonic inspection, flux leakage. So all of these different methods out there are mostly variations off the six most common methods that we'll talk about a little bit later. Right, so what are some of the uses of these different NDT methods, right? So you're looking for flaw detection and evaluation, right? So is there some sort of flaw inherent in this piece, right? Commonly seen in, say, welds or casting, you're gonna see porosity or lack of fusion or inclusions in your cast or weld that are going to, you know, compromise the structural integrity of it, right? You can use it for leak detection, right? So in a pressure vessel or some sort of storage tank, you're searching for leaks coming out of it, right? Third simple leak test is soapy water that you spray over a pressurized capsule, say a compressor bottle or a scuba bottle, and you look for bubbles, right? That's a very basic visual leak test. Location determination, right? So you can use different NDT methods to accurately locate the flaw or the defective area. You know, not all methods tell you exactly where the defect is. They just tell you that there is one, right? You can use these different methods to exactly pinpoint where that location is. Dimensional measurements, right? Well, we talked about that earlier. You can use it to measure, you know, exact details on a part, right? So you can define, you know, how big is a machined surface, you know, how big of a hole is it, how are the overall dimensional measurements of the material, right? Structure, microstructure characterization, right? You're looking at the interior or the microstructures on a piece, right? So is it very smooth? Is it porous? Is it rough edged? You know, what are the structure, overall structural characteristics of a surface or of a material, right? Is it, you know, a machined steel surface? Is it a laminate material? All that factors in. You can determine it all, right? Does it have a coating on it? Estimation of mechanical and physical properties, right? So this is one that's come through empirical information, right, from testing, from destructively testing thousands and thousands of different parts and materials, and through that then we know what the measurement, the NDT measurement characteristics of those parts were, and so if we tested another piece and we see that it matches the characteristics of this thing that we have extensively tested destructively, we know approximately what its mechanical and physical properties are, you know, what's its load bearing, what's its corrosion and erosion rate based on these factors, We can determine that using different types of NDT. Stress and dynamic response measurements, right? So how much is a piece going to flex? How is it going to react when you put stress or strain on a material, right? It could be physical stress, or it could be electrical or chemical stresses. How is this piece going to respond to that? Lastly, we have material sorting and chemical composition determination. So you have positive material identification, which uses a radiation source, and you are essentially using that source to see what sort of feedback you get, and that'll tell you what the composition of that material is. You can look at conductivity testing, that will give you an idea of what the composition of the material is, or determining, steel alloys, you use what's called a spark test, which you essentially burn a very tiny amount of the steel, and spectral analysis of the resulting gas will tell you what the exact chemical composition of that steel is. Yeah, so continuing on, what are the NDT methods used for, right? Can be used, there are NDE, right? So NDE stands for non-destructive examination, same concept as NDT, synonyms for each other. can be used at any stage in the production or life cycle of a component, right? To assist in product development, right? So you're prototyping a bunch of different pieces, and you can use it to identify what's good and bad about the different prototypes. You can use to screen or sort incoming materials. So as you're bringing in raw materials, you want to make sure it is what you think it is, or make sure there's no defects, right? Say you're manufacturing from, a steel block and you're going to machine it down, you might want to know if there's any gaps or shunts or voids inside that machine piece, that block of steel before you machine it, because if you start machining and you hit a void, right, and you're probably going to ruin the piece you're working on, and now you've just wasted the money on that block of steel and your time and worn out your machinery. To monitor, improve, or control manufacturing processes, right? So while you're manufacturing something, you could be testing pieces as they're being produced, and you can see we're getting a 10% failure rate at this process point. What can we do to address that? There's things like continuous automated ultrasound and x-ray and eddy current that all happen, when normal one is, producing things like raw materials like sheets of steel, blocks of steel, pipeline, railroad line, all typically use these automated continuous inspection systems while they're being produced. Visual inspection, right? I have a camera, laser systems watching it as well. You can use it to verify proper processing, such as heat treating or coatings, like paint and anodization. You can use NDT to test and verify all that. Verify proper assembly, make sure it's actually put together properly, assembled properly, whether that's, physical assembly through nuts and bolts or through welding methods, right, even all the way up through explosive welding. They'll typically x-ray that piece, make sure you have full fusion all the way through the pieces. And then to inspect for in-service damage, right? And that is, corrosion, erosion, stress fractures, everything. Any sort of wear or damage that can happen on a piece once it's in service, you can also be inspecting for that, right? And the first five of those are typically grouped in as quality assurance and quality control. And the sixth one is typically what we would define as non-destructive inspection, non-destructive testing, non-destructive examination. Right, those are kind of two different halves of the same industry. Right, so then we have the six most common NDT methods, and then also the six methods that we at the Ocean Corporation train in. and they kind of make the foundation of all the other methods that come, right? Almost every other method is some variation on one of these six methods. Right, so first we have visual inspection. So visual inspection is very basic, very common. It's done anytime you're doing any other type of NDT inspection, right? So if you're doing ultrasound or x-ray or mag particle, you're also going to do a visual inspection on the piece first. Right, it pretty much just boils down to physically looking at the piece or the material for visual defects, right? That can be just your naked eye. You can also use things like fiberscopes and borescopes, magnifying systems, microscopes, mirrors, so you can look inside different elements, right? And it's just, like I said, you're visually looking for some sort of defect. Right here on the right, we can see a portable video inspection unit with zoom, right? So it allows inspection of large tanks and vessels, railroad tank cars, sewer lines, right? Anything that is large and cumbersome and you need to get a close-up visual look at. You know, they're starting to use things like drones and crawlers for that purpose. Robotic crawlers permit observation in hazardous or tight areas such as air ducts, reactors, pipelines. They're also used on the surface of tanks, right? And, you know, they're starting to use drones as well for tall structures. Liquid penetrant inspection, right? So a liquid with a high surface wetting characteristic is applied to the surface of the part and allowed time to seep into surface breaking defects, right? You then wipe off the excess liquid, and the developer, typically it's a powder, is applied to pull the trapped penetrant out of the defect and spread it on the surface where it can be seen. So you then visually look at the part and see where that dye is visible, right? Because there shouldn't be any dye on the part, right? If there's no defects, surface breaking defects on the part, then you won't see any dyes, right? Because you've wiped off the excess. The only dye that's left is what has flowed into the surface defect. Right, you can also use fluorescent pigmented dyes so that they show up very bright under black light. The principle that dye penetrant is based on is called capillary action, which is where liquids are drawn into spaces where two surfaces are very close together, right? So you can see it if you take like a very narrow straw or something similar and you put it in a glass of water, the liquid in that straw will be higher than liquid in the water. That's through capillary action, which is a dynamic interaction between the narrow space and the surface tension of the liquid. So magnetic particle inspection is the next most common method, and that functions using electromagnetic fields and then dyed iron particles, essentially. So the part is magnetized. Finely milled iron particles coated with a dye pigment are then applied to the specimen. These particles are attracted to magnetic flux leakage fields and will cluster to form an indication directly over this continuity. This indication can be visually detected under proper lighting conditions. Also can be dyed. Can also, like dye penetrant, use fluorescent dye pigments so that they show up on black light very clearly. The principle that this works under is when you have a surface or near surface flaw or crack where you have a separation of your metal surface from each other, you essentially get magnetic poles, new magnetic poles from your magnetic induction. So as we all hopefully remember from high school science classes, the poles of the magnet are where the magnetic field is at the strongest, which is why the iron filings line up along those faults and cracks. Alright, so this is some pictures that we're looking at of some very fine cracks that are highlighted using fluorescent magnetic particle inspection. Alright, magnetic particle is one of the most common types of inspection methods done. Radiography, it's essentially x-ray, right? Just like in the medical field, the radiation used in radiography testing is higher energy, so a shorter wavelength version of the electromagnetic waves that we see as visible light every day, right? So we have this huge spectrum of electromagnetic radiation, right? From radio waves on one end of the spectrum, all the way up to gamma rays, which will be very bad stuff. You don't want gamma rays to be hitting you that we can use to inspect stuff. You know, in the industrial area, we can use gamma rays for industrial inspection, right? You can't use gamma rays if you're doing, in the medical field, on people or animals. It ends very poorly. But x-ray passes through the material, a physical solid material, so that it can expose film on the other side of a material like that. So we can get kind of a visual representation of that on the next slide. So the part is placed between the radiation source and a piece of film. The part will stop some of the radiation, thicker, more dense area will stop more of the radiation. Right, so the film darkness will vary with the amount of radiation reaching the film through the test object, right? So the lighter, in this visual indication, the lighter area has less exposure, the darker area has more exposure. You can see we have a kind of chicken-shaped defect on that steel plate and engraving, so we can see that defect in that looks like a laminated steel plate because it's not, there's less material there, so more radiation passes through. All right, so some different X-ray radiographic images. We have X-ray of a machined part here, and we can see some defect areas inside that part where it's darker. Yeah. So, eddy current testing is another form of electromagnetic testing using electromagnetic induction, similar to magnetic particle, except in this one, we are actually measuring the magnetic field strength off the part that we're testing. Right, so we're measuring through the magnetic field that they induce eddy currents in the part, right? So what an eddy current is if you generate an electromagnetic field and then bury that field next to a conductive material like a metal such as copper or aluminum, that change in magnetic field induces an electric current in that conductive material such as the copper plate or steel plate, whatever it happens to be, right? And we can actually learn a lot of information by looking at the magnetic field generated from those eddy currents. So it can tell us things like the thickness of a material, the conductive material, it can tell us the conductivity of a material, it can tell us if there's any sort of coating on it, it can identify defects or indications. All of these things are determinable using eddy current inspection. There's a lot more to it than that, but that's the gist of it. You use an electric coil, and you send an alternating current through that coil. That alternating current generates a perpetually expanding and collapsing electromagnetic field, which that expanding and contracting electromagnetic field induces eddy currents in the test piece. Right, and by looking at the variations in the eddy current's magnetic field, that's what determines all those different factors that I was telling about, right? Conductivity thickness, coating thickness, defects, identify temperature ranges on a material, all of that. Right, it's particularly well suited for detecting surface cracks. It can also be used to make electrical conductivity and coating thickness measurements. In this image on the left, a small surface probe is scanned over the part's surface and attempts to detect a crack. Alright, so ultrasonic inspection is just very similar to how you see in the medical field, as you are shooting high-frequency sound waves into a material. And then as they go through, they are reflected back either from the back of the material, right? So the far end of, say, a plate or a small piece, and you're listening for that echo, and based on the time of flight, it can tell you the thickness of that material, right? Or if there's an internal crack or damaged area, that will also reflect the sound waves back to you, and you will see an indication at a point that's short of what the expected thickness of the material is. Right, reflected sound energy is displayed versus time, and the inspector can visualize a cross section of the specimen showing the depth of features that reflect the sound. Right, so if you have internal structures in that material, you're going to see them reflected back at you. Right, so high resolution images can be produced by plotting signal strength or time of flight using a computer controlled scanning system. right? These are grayscale images produced using that exact technique of a coin. You can see just how much detail you can actually produce. Remember, this is not a picture of a quarter. This is the sound image generated using advanced ultrasound techniques. So some of those common applications of NDT, right? The inspection of raw products, so raw materials as they come in, right? To make sure there's no defects before you start production and refining them into finished products. Inspection following secondary processing. So you've produced the component, now you're gonna heat treat it, you're gonna anodize it, coat it somehow. You can ensure that your secondary processing was done correctly and your product is good to go. And then you can also use it for in-service damage inspection, right? So, you know, with aircraft, you have a ton of rivet points. Around each of those rivets, you have stress fractures and fatigue, so you can identify and map how much damage has been done and when that section of the aircraft needs to be replaced or repaired. You can look at corrosion and erosion on the inside of pipelines, right? Typically, that's done either using ultrasound, right? And they call it corrosion mapping. You can see how much wall thickness has been lost on that pipe. You know, you see stress fractures and all kinds of materials that are typically designed to flex and deflex, right? So like hull of aircraft, wind turbine blades, all of this. You're looking for any sort of damage, wear, tear on a part that's in service. So inspection raw products and raw materials, right? So forgings, castings, extrusions, other types of raw material production, right? So with forgings, you can see, you know, lack of fusion or cold shunts, things of that nature. With castings, you're likely to see things like porosity, also lack of fusion in areas, inclusions all happen with castings. You know, extrusions, you can see, you know, where a metal typically is extruded through some sort of die under tremendous temperature and tremendous pressure, forces it into shape. And you can see, you know, you want to make sure that, you know, if it's not done under the proper conditions, you can see all kinds of problems like work hardening happening. If it's not done hot enough, you can see, you know, warpage and other defects that will impact the usability of that raw material. Right, inspection following secondary processing, right? So you're machining something, you're welding something, grinding, heat treating, plating, electrolyzing, machining, welding, heat treating, plating, coatings. Those are all secondary processing. So, you know, if you've machined something, if that's not done properly, you can get excess wear on a piece, or you can get work hardening. Same thing with grinding. You know, welding, you're also likely to see porosity or lack of fusion. Inclusions all happens with welding. With the heat treatment, you want to make sure that the heat treatment was done properly so you get the correct material properties. You know, platings and coatings, you want to make sure you have the proper plating thickness, proper coating thickness. Make sure it's attached securely to the surface of your material. It's not going to fall off, right? Those are all things that could happen after a secondary processing. Right, and then in-service damage. That's what we're talking about. Cracking, corrosion, erosion, heat damage, right? These are all things that happen to parts once they're in service. Your standard wear and tear on a material, right? You want to be able to identify it, track it, and then repair and or replace that part when it needs to happen. That way that, you know, you don't have catastrophic failure that results in, you know, injury, loss of life, or excessive financial damages, right, because of it. You know, think of a petrochemical plant exploding, aircraft falling out of the sky, pipeline leaking oil into the environment. These are all things that routine inspection of in-service systems are supposed to prevent. Right, so, and we have different sectors of the industry that we're inspecting, right? So power plant inspection is a big one, right? We all need power, we all need electricity, right? So periodically power plants are shut down for inspection, right? The main thing being inspected in most power plants is going to be their heat exchangers, right? Because the way that almost all power plants function in the United States is through generating tremendous heat, using that heat to turn water into steam, and that steam builds pressure, and that pressure is used to turn turbines, which generate the electricity. Right, so a heat exchanger is a massive bundle of tubes. You can see one end of a heat exchanger in the picture on the lower left. Each of those tubes is designed to carry heat from one location to another, right? And they're predominantly inspected using eddy current, right? So we can see an eddy current probe here in the middle of your screen that's fed through those pipelines. And based on the feedback from that probe, we can determine, you know, if and where there has been some sort of damage or failure of each of those different tubes in the eddy current system and the heat exchanger system. Right, so we use wire rope in all kinds of industries, everything from ski lifts to offshore oil and gas into shipping and receiving. Right, wire rope is a very high tensile strength system. We use it in bridges. Suspension bridges are all produced using wire rope. Predominantly, they're inspected using electromagnetic devices and then visual inspection. Right, so you're looking for frays and tears and damage on each of these wire ropes, and there's some sort of, you know, loss of material rating before they need to replace that wire rope. Storage tanks, right? So it's mostly petrochemical, but also water storage. All use above ground storage tanks. usually they're now inspected using robotic crawlers, which will drive along the exterior interior of the tank, typically taking ultrasound readings of the thickness there, looking for thinning due to corrosion predominantly. Right, and if you're doing underground storage tanks, you typically will take essentially a giant borescope or cameras on articulating arms that go down inside that tank, and you take a visual look around it. Alright, so aircraft inspection is a huge sector of the industry. So both during the manufacturing of aircraft as well as in-service aircraft. Right, so as an aircraft is in operation, its cabin is constantly pressurized and depressurized and pressurized and depressurized, which causes, constant stretching and compression and stretching of and compression of the skin of that aircraft. So around each of the rivet points, you'll see stress fractures and fatigue fractures from that constant flexing and deflexing also in the wings. Anyone who's been in a plane full while it's flying knows how much flex there is in the wings from when it's on the ground to when the wings are supporting the aircraft. Right, they flex up and down and up and down, and all along you'll see stress areas. Right, lightning strikes can cause damaged aircraft where they heat up one section of the aircraft incredibly high, which causes a cascade of problems because, you know, now it's throwing the heat treatment out of whack, it's melted some areas that section of the aircraft can no longer, you know, be as flexible or stretch and behave mechanically the same way the rest of the aircraft, which adds some additional dynamic stress points on the aircraft. Fun fact, the reason why windows on aircraft are all curved is because the very first aircraft had square cornered windows. That corner, that hard corner on the aircraft, caused a stress focal point, which caused that part of the aircraft to fail much more easily than when they did switch to round windows, and so the earliest aircraft had a very high failure rate due to the square cornered aircraft windows, right? The cabin essentially explosively depressurized and the plane would not end well. Right? So beyond just the skin of the aircraft, the jet engine has to be inspected, right? This is something that's spinning at tens of thousands of RPMs under massive dynamic loads. So there are very, very detailed inspections are performed on them, typically after so many service hours, they're completely pulled apart and inspected top to bottom, right? Right, mostly they're using fluorescent penetrant inspection, right? Because a lot of what you see on engine aircraft is surface cracking on different components, both on the, you know, axle systems and gearing systems, as well as on the fan blades of the turbofan aircraft engine systems. So, right, why we do this, right? Like I mentioned earlier, aircraft crashes, you know, pipeline explosions, right? So United Flight 232, all the way back in 1989, it crashed because there was a tiny defect in the disc of the engine, which caused that engine to explosively disintegrate and threw, you know, damage into the wings and the capsule of the aircraft, which caused it to break apart. Right, we talked about pressure vessels, right? Mostly you're doing things like x-ray and ultrasound inspection on pressure vessels, looking for, you know, thinning of the wall or damage in the welds that could cause the pressure vessel to explosively decompress and break apart, right? Just like an aircraft would do because it's a giant flying pressure vessel. You know, things like compressor tanks, scuba bottle tanks, all are subjected to, you know, pipe propane tanks, both home propane tanks as well as industrial scale propane tanks, and natural gas tanks all have a huge amount of inspection on, because if they fail, it's a very big problem. The failure of pressure vessel controls and the rapid release of a large amount of energy. To protect against this dangerous event, the tanks are inspected using radiography and ultrasonic testing. Right, rail inspection. So rail inspection, right? Railroad line inspection. There's hundreds of thousands of miles of railroad line just in the United States. And they all have to be inspected, right? If you ever see the trucks or you see the special lone rail cars moving along on the railroad tracks, they're performing inspection. Almost universally, they're doing ultrasound and visual inspection on those rail lines as they go along. And that's dramatically ramped up in recent years. Sperry Rail, Nordco are the two main railroad line inspections, right? And the reason it's ramped up recently is the overwhelming majority of our railroad lines were built in the post-World War II era, right? So late 1940s, early 1950s and 60s. And we've seen a, you know, we're nearing the end of a lot of this railroad line's expected lifetime. So they're having to go in and inspect and repair huge swaths of this infrastructure all across the country, and massive amounts of our goods and raw materials are transported via rails. The most efficient way after shipping, large naval shipping, to transport goods and materials around the world, right? So we have to inspect that very, very super critical component of our nation's infrastructure. Right, so the United States alone has almost 600,000 highway bridges, right, over, you know, water spans as well as, you know, roadway spans, right? Corrosion, cracking, and other damage can all affect a bridge's performance, can all cause them to fail catastrophically. You know, the collapse of the Silver Bridge in 1967 resulted in a loss of 47 lives, right? It was a very dramatic bridge collapse, unexpected. You know, most bridges get a visual inspection every 2 years, and then typically on some other basis, they're a more detailed inspection using other methods happens on a more sporadic basis, depending on the type of bridge, whether it's suspension bridge or steel girder bridge design versus concrete bridge design. They all have different requirements around how they're inspected. There are some bridges that are fitted with acoustic emission sensors that listen for sounds of cracks growing, right? So you can, you know, put a device on, say, a concrete bridge, and it can hear, you know, the cracking as it propagates through that concrete. We're starting to use, you know, traditionally they would use specialty trucks with kind of a robotic arm that held, you know, like cherry picker arm almost, that held people in it as that truck drove along. They could watch, look at the side of the bridge. We're starting to use drones more and more for that purpose. They can be programmed to fly up and fly a route along the side of that bridge to give a visual inspection of it, and they can catalog and track cracks as they propagate through that bridge, so they know when they need to go in and perform a massive repair or replacement of the bridge. Right, pipeline inspection is another massive sector of the industry, mostly in oil and gas, right? But there's all kinds of pipelines. It's very critical for oil and gas because oil leak can be very, very damaging to the local environment, something we don't want. Not to mention it's very expensive to lose lots of oil, right? Oil companies aren't happy with that. Right, there's multiple different types of inspection on pipelines, right? One of the primary ones when the pipeline's being built is they're doing x-ray inspection on all the welds as it's being manufactured, right, as they're laying down that pipeline, right? And then when each section of pipeline is being manufactured, they're doing x-ray, ultrasound, typically automated depending on the type of pipeline, right? If there's an automated extrusion system for that pipeline, they'll do that. If it's a rolled pipeline and then welded at a seam, right, they're going to do typically mag particle or liquid penetrant inspection on that seam, and spot x-rays, depending on the necessity of it. Sometimes they'll do ultrasound, shear wave or phased array, which are types of ultrasound inspection on the welds of the pipeline. You can also have internal crawlers or pigs that will go inside the pipeline, and they can do everything from just a visual inspection to automated ultrasound inspection. They can do x-ray as well, where you have the pig move through the pipeline and stop at specific junctures, take an x-ray and move on to the next juncture. And then you can have magnetic flux leakage inspection, works very similar to eddy current inspection, and it moves through inducing electromagnetic fields into the pipeline, and then it looks for where that flux is stronger, that magnetic field lines are stronger than they should be. That's indicative of a crack or some sort of flaw where those magnetic field lines are able to leak out of that part, that section of pipeline. There are many pigs that do all of the above simultaneously, in fact. Right, you can go in and perform, very precise special measurements, right? So, Boeing got the opportunity to send their employees to inspect the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia, right? So they're looking for damage, excess damage, right? We all know the Liberty Bell, there's a big crack from a cast, right? The bell was a cast piece, and then when they rang it cracked, and it's a piece of American culture now. We don't want it to continue to fail, we want it to remain stable, right? So they used eddy current measurements to measure the electrical conductivity of the bell to make sure it's uniform and it's not losing material, not propagating new cracks, that sort of thing. That's all we have. Thank you very much for learning about nondestructive testing. All right.